Echo Fox will still.
Hello and welcome back to the Dive. It is season 3, episode 16.
Woo! Super prepared. He knew that the whole time.
We never have to read off of scripts. But we're coming back off of MSI. This is going to be the MSI recovery episode.
Oh, have you guys not done one since then?
Uh-uh.
Nope.
So this is the first one.
Is this where we get to downplay G2's success?
Moving on.
I'm interested to hear your take on it,
Mark. No, it was just a joke because...
It's the hotline leaks.
Yeah, that's Travis getting flamed on his YouTube channel. Sorry. Go flame him.
Yeah. Everyone disliked his video. Because some negative comments about G2, I think. Basically. I didn't really know the full context.
Yeah, that's
it.
I
just saw him complaining about it.
What a bad boy.
Yeah.
Honestly, though, how are you guys feeling about going into Worlds off of last year's Worlds? Both EU and NA did much better than historically they have. EU got finals. We got semifinals. And here at MSI, again, both of us getting finals, one of us winning.
By a little. It was close, competitive series.
Small margin. Game,
who showed up on the day, you know?
Any given Sunday. I'm excited. I think it's awesome, right? Yeah, we got blasted by G2 in the finals. Mm-hmm. That wasn't close. And people were disappointed about that. And I get that. I was disappointed too, right? It was a hard series to watch. But that being said, you know, If I told you going into MSI that we were going to make finals and get destroyed, you would have been like, hell yeah, let's go. Let's get smashed in those finals. Well, I mean, we've had our two best international results ever now back to back. That is extremely promising. I think that is so exciting, you know, as far as a time to be an NA fan. And, you know, and I look back to Fnatic, you know, making finals last year at Worlds, and they got blasted, right? And Caps is now here winning an international title and showing people that it is achievable. It's not just that, you know, if you're a Western team, if you're from EU or NA, mm-hmm. you are only playing for scraps. You can actually be the best team in the world. And I think, you know, G2 has shown that, and that's so exciting.
I wouldn't go into Worlds, like, since you talked about, like, projecting forward, I wouldn't go in being like, we're now going to, like, beat IG again or anything like that, because that felt like a crazy, crazy upset, and that's what makes them so cool. But it does feel good for the region as a whole to think, like, well...
You can compete, though.
Yeah, we can compete. The playoffs in NA were really competitive, so, like, TSM and C9 are hopefully around Team Liquid's level, so if they're the ones who make it to NA or to Worlds, that like we'll actually have the competitive group stage where more than just like one team is our savior, which was C9 the last couple of years. Like it would be cool if two NA teams got out of groups. Wouldn't that be wild? You know, like I'm ready for that reality.
Dare to dream.
I think I'm ready for it. I think it could happen.
That's one of the things I was most excited for, because like Team Liquid doing so well, you know, defeating the world, defending world champions, making it to finals and everything. And I was like, you like that? We got two more of these at least.
We got three of them
back here in NA.
Oh, three total.
Yeah. Yeah.
I was like, who's
two more?
Yeah.
Sorry, I'm not taking away the original one. But that makes people also really excited, looking forward to even just Rift Rivals.
Yeah.
Because now EU NA Rift Rivals is a premier event coming off of an EU NA final.
Best two regions in the world.
Mm-hmm. Where, I mean, people are memeing it a lot. But literally, we defeated SK Telecom and Invictus Gaming.
Like, yeah.
Those are super legitimate claims now to, you know, the EU NA Rift Rivals being like this super hype event. And we do get to see the deeper rosters, right? Mm. People do get to have TSM and Cloud9 there. All the people that were like, oh no, why did we send Team Liquid? I wish we had X team, you know, because of all the reverse sweeps. Now we get to see, you know, top three from all of them stacked up.
Yeah,
that's gonna be fun.
I'm actually so excited for looking forward to Rift Rivals and Worlds. You know, as you said, we had three teams that were super competitive. You know, if we are assuming that Team Liquid having success on the international stage is indicative of the level of the other teams, you know, even if like you can't get all teams out of groups or anything like that, you know, the world in which it's three teams that could be competing to get out of the group that are on that level, I think mm-hmm. is very, very exciting. And for Rift Rivals, I think it's awesome too, because, you know, I look back to last year's Rift Rivals, and I think a lot of fans were understandably frustrated around the 100 Thieves situation, and the fact, you know, that the 100 Thieves had kind of ended up tanking before it, and then they were, you know, testing out Academy players and everything. And I think people are really excited to see, you know, kind of a good foot forward for our region, you know, to see these three teams that almost everyone is going to unanimously agree we're the strongest, you know, being, you know, representatives for Rift Rivals.
Yeah, I'm super excited for it. I still think G2, it will be the strongest team there.
Yep. Shocker. After they 3-0 their own region, then 3-0 ours.
Yeah. So, like, it's definitely going to be interesting how the format looks this year. I haven't heard the final, like, cut on what the format is going to be. Like, you know, like, point systems and stuff. It's going to be the same as last year or whatever.
I think it's the same as last year.
Okay. Because then we still have a chance to win the tournament, even if
two of our
even if G2 is literally the best.
Because the final thing is the best of five, where they have to like rotate in and out.
Yeah.
So your best team can play twice, but they can't play more than twice.
Yeah.
Right.
So theoretically, if G2 gets them two wins, then you could still win by never beating G2.
My concern a little bit is just what some of the comments have been by some of the pro players, because they sometimes seem like, oh, it's in the middle of our season and we're doing all this other stuff and there's no like prize for winning this. But I think with the fact that NA and EU were the two finalists, hopefully that gives more importance to the tournament, even for them to be like, hey, we're not just like fighting at the bottom of the table and like a laughing stock. Like, we're actually potentially two of the best regions in the world. And now I get to compete against potentially the best, one of the other best regions in the world for practice, for like honor or whatever. Because I think a lot of EU fans and NA fans have a lot of riding on this, whereas, you know, last year I don't think NA felt like, oh, even if we did well at Rift Rivals, it meant a ton. Whereas now it's like, if we can beat Origin and Fnatic, like, okay, yeah, G2 is like a super team, but the rest of your region's not that great. We're better. And for Europe, you know, like, you want to go in, beat them, be like, not only is G2 our super team, but we're better as a whole. And so I think fans are going to care a lot more about this Rift Rivals, and I hope that bleeds into the pro players who, when it's so far out right now, sound a little like meh on it.
Oh no, I've been caring a lot about you versus NA for 10 years, Mark.
Yeah, but you know what, like, it ebbs and flows, and like how
literally
big
were flaming me before there was even a server in Korea. It was EU versus NA. That right. That's how it started. It was Wicked and Hotshot. Where is the first EU versus NA rivalry that I remember, because they both played top lane. And
I remember the stream 200 ping scrims across the ocean. I remember those days. Yeah.
So it's definitely an old river that runs very deep.
Yeah, well, it's gonna be really exciting. I think looking forward, people definitely should be very happy, I think, overall with the results that NA has been putting forward internationally. But with that, let's look forward to Summer Split. Summer Split obviously going to be starting this weekend. There have been some changes among the teams. We are going to do power rankings, but we'll probably talk mostly about, you know, teams that we think are going to be doing a lot better or worse. Some of the teams that got some new players. You know, the three couple of some of the major pickups that I can really think of, or changes if you want to call them that. Obviously, we had Amazing coming, joining 100 Thieves. TSM has moved Grig back to the starting spot, so him and Acadian are apparently going to be sharing time there, and they actually picked up an Academy jungler, so assuming they're actually actively going to be swapping back and forth, you know, would probably be what's happening there. And the 100 Thieves team is looking a little bit different. They're using Soligo also.
And Cody's son.
Oh, yeah, and Cody's son. Yeah, so actually...
And Wadeed.
Yeah, for FlyQuest, yeah.
Yeah, changes everywhere.
Yeah, there are actually quite a few changes, yeah.
I mean, I think we should start at the top of our list if we're going to do the power ranking list.
Mm-hmm.
So, the top three that we've been talking about already for the show, Team Liquid, Cloud9, and TSM, what are your order for the top three, Mark? Do you even have a different team in the top three?
No, my top three are the same, yeah. But I have TSM number one, TL number two, and C9 number three.
Okay.
I actually have TSM above them, yeah.
Wait, say it again?
I said TSM number one.
Okay.
TL number two, C9 number three.
Okay.
So remember, this is regular season.
Yeah.
Right.
Regular season predictions. This is not actually who wins. And I'm actually the same, for the simple reason of
I'm going for the shock value. You're one of you needs to be normal. What are you?
I have Team Liquid even lower. Is that more shock?
Maybe. I don't know.
That just sounds like you've gone crazy.
So
I'll have reasoning. I'll let
yeah. So I mean, my thought process is simply that, like, I still think Team Liquid is the odds-on favorite to win the championship in summer and to win again. I just think that there is a real come down after an international event, where, you know, they were just competing to be the best team in the world. You know, they were, you know, playing against all these, you know, high stakes things, and they are taking a break after that, right? Yes, they are back to scrims now. Whereas, you know, a team like TSM is going to be so hungry, I think, to prove themselves after having lost in the finals in reverse sweep. I think they're going to come out of the gates swinging, where I think, you know, TL is more likely to have a slower couple early weeks, right? And it's not even that, like, I'm saying I don't think TL could is the best team anymore. It's more that I think their record in summer will be off to a slower start and they'll finish lower in the standings as a result.
Why did you put them at second then? I have the same reasoning. I put them even lower.
Because I still think that they're so good that they're going to win a lot of games.
They literally just started practicing yesterday.
Yeah.
Like, they haven't done any scrims, and everything, all the work that they have been doing was on the MSI patch. Like, Scuttlecrab is the old Scuttlecrab spawning early and everything. Like, there's so much that's going to change. I expect, and the way that the schedule is with TSM having to play, or Team Liquid having to play TSM again right at the beginning, I expect TSM to win that game. And I think that Team Liquid are, and deservedly so, I think the players should get a break after, you know, so much international success and, you know, the top teams never have enough off time. But I do think that it is going to cause the very typical lag of the first place team at the beginning of next split. We've seen it for so many years now. The team that goes over to MSI will come back, have a very slow start, and it is due to practicing on the previous patch and then having a vacation afterwards. And it brings up this topic of burnout.
Yeah. Before we get into burnout, I think the other thing too is like Azale was saying, the stakes are lower and like your competition is lower. So like, it's just hard to get up to the same level of like, you know, like it's hard to explain to people who don't compete, but like when you're going up against someone you're expecting to beat, and it's for nothing, it's for a regular season win compared to like, oh, I just played a best of five versus G2 to be the best team in the world. Like, it's hard to reach the same levels of energy and engagement. So let alone the fact that you're potentially burned out and all this other stuff. It's just like, I'm not playing, you know, Teddy and Mata in scrims every day. And yeah. Like honing steel on steel necessarily. Like, I think all that combines to make a very slow start for Team Liquid.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing I want to say before we get into burnout was just the TSM point about the junglers, in case we don't get back to this. I think TSM, traditionally, historically, the way they've used subs is pretty bad, in quotation marks, depending on what you're trying to get out of it. If you're just trying to make the best five-man roster, I think what they do is fine. Mm-hmm. But between having Turtle saying that they would bring Grig back last split when they didn't use him at all, a number of other times that they've had like people behind someone ready to go, they never use them. And so I think whoever ends up being the better jungler for the team will just see like 100% of the playtime come like even the after like 2 weeks or 3 weeks.
Yeah, so you feel like when TSM talks about using their substitutes and stuff like that, it's more of tryouts. We haven't figured out.
Yeah, that's what it feels to me. It's not a substitution system. It's like it's a depth chart battle. and like eventually someone wins. Turtle never saw playtime once Doublelift came back. I expect, you know, if Grig is better than Acadian, they'll just select him. And so, like, that's why I don't think it's going to be a problem for TSM between, like, finding synergy between the two.
The one thing that, like, I normally would be 100% agreed with you, and it may end up being that regardless, but the one thing that made me think they actually might be trying, you know, giving a real shot at this is, A, their coaching has changed. You know, it is Zix now. And B, they picked up a separate Academy jungler, right? So, you know, most teams, when they are doing this sort of thing, they're saying, oh, yeah, they're going to be a substitution role, but actually one of them is just our Academy player, and he's going to be playing Academy, and the other guy's going to be the starter, and he's going to be playing LCS, right? Mm-hmm. And there's not a lot of overlap. The fact that they actually have three junglers and one is listed, you know, other than these two as the starting Academy guy, what kind of made me think, hey, maybe they're actually giving this a real shot. Of trying to set it up like some of these teams have been successful with it in the past, right? When we've seen even Cloud9 regionally do it, and SKT famously had done it for many years.
Yeah, I mean, I think the bringing the extra jungler is a very good point, because like, you know, Dardoch and Meteos did swap time, but one of them was always playing in Academy last split. The thing about Zix, though, I disagree, because I don't know if this is still spilling the tea or anything, but like
I haven't heard of that.
You never heard spill the tea?
No.
Spill the tea, sis?
No.
It's just like what you say when someone's like got drama and they're dropping like the inside knowledge. Spill the tea. You guys are old. I know I'm the same age, but Jesus.
I don't know. You're the one talking about drinking tea.
One of the problems that Zix ran into, and one of the reasons he was let go of, was because he wasn't swapping rosters and experimenting. And he's always been super set in his ways of like, these are the five guys I'm working with. And he doesn't, even if he mixes scrims for a little bit, they never see playtime. And so
people
like
change, Mark.
Maybe people change, but I'm betting against it.
I like that. This is our first tea that has been spilled on the dot.
You guys have never spilled tea before?
Are the tea is being spilled? Here,
you have to pour some out.
Pour some tea out? Yeah, okay. This is tea, by the way.
Pour one out for the homies?
Yeah. Oh, you actually did. What are you doing? You madman.
You think I'm not going to follow through, Mark?
He doesn't back down. What
else can I get Kobe to do? Bet you won't jump on.
I really like bringing up the point about the extra jungler, though, because that is one of the biggest mentality shifts, right?
Yeah.
And that's part of this whole substitution thing is like,
I'm not laughing at you. I'm just
one person. I know. I'm playing through it.
Yeah.
That's one of the biggest things is the mentality. And that's kind of the hardest battle for me when people are discussing all these like 10-man rosters and substitutions and stuff like that. It's the environment for these players. And this is such a mentally exhaustive game that it's very important to have the players like in a good state with feeling about sharing time and all that type of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So if they're like, all right, I'm not the lower rung here, I'm not the academy one or whatever, and they're actually sharing time, I still think it's a problem to share time literally, mm-hmm. though, because you have to split time in scrims, you have to like you split time on stage for LCS, it's not going to work.
Yeah, I think in the like happy, fun, you know, everything is great world where both people are fully bought in, both people are the best of friends, both people are really happy to see the other guy play.
And they got different play styles.
Different play styles, and there's, you know, everything is working. Damn, that is good, right? Like, that is really, really good. But it is so hard to not feel like, oh, he's stealing my job. Oh, if he does too well, ooh, maybe I don't get to play anymore. Oh, shit, you know.
Like, you have a bad scrim game and you turbo in, and then suddenly it's like, oh, that might have hurt my chances of playing this weekend.
Yeah, I mean, we've heard Medios even talk about this, and this is a very real thing, I think. You know, the whole idea of even when I was playing WoW, when people started having four-man rosters and sometimes there'd be overlapping classes, is the whole idea of, like, do you really want to help that person fix their issues? Yep. If I'm like, oh, Kobe's doing this thing wrong, but like, I don't know if I really want to tell him because I'm trying to keep that spot, right? Like, you're training your replacement, so to speak. And I know Medios had talked about that in the past and how that can be a really weird dynamic on teams where it's like, especially if you have the one guy who's supposed to be, you know, the veteran player, and then the other guy who's supposed to be, you know, there as this like mechanical god or whatever and supposed to be getting kind of trained up.
I always, like, coming from the traditional sports world, I'm always like, I kind of hate hearing that mindset, but I can't deny that it is very, like, a very human reaction to it, where it's like, you want to be like, we're a team and we're all going to get better together, kind of, but you know.
People in pro gaming are not brought up in that environment. That is the biggest difference to me. You're not like, if I'm in the NBA, I played, you know, like, as a little kid in a for fun league, and then I played in my public school, and then I played in my high school, and then I played in college, and now I'm in the NBA, and I've been in the system the whole time. You know, being a pro gamer is like, I sat alone and played on my computer and I was really good. And now I'm put with these other people and I have to do what they say. And it's like a very different shift.
All right. Right now, where do you lie on the Grig versus Acadian? Who do you think is going to be the most useful?
Acadian.
What was that? Damn. Did we get that on camera?
Acadian. No, but it was... the cheek thing? I don't know what that was.
You told me it.
You're full in the Acadian camp. All right.
I'm full because I think the biggest problem I've seen with TSM over the last couple of years is sometimes they fall into like a very controlled play pattern, mm-hmm. and they don't take big risks. And we've seen internationally how important it is to be willing to take plays that are not 90-10 plays, like go for the 60-40 sometimes. Yeah. And I think sometimes you watch Acadian do something really dumb and like kill himself, but I think he's also that spark plug that their early game needs, which I like a lot more than Grig, who I think is really controlled.
Yeah, the thing to me, like I my mind is telling me kind of the same thing, but in the back of my head, I'm like, well, then why would they even put Grig back in the starting position, right? Because Grig has been away from the team for a while. I didn't think that he was going to even get a shot to be back like on the LCS stage unless he had really proven himself to be better in scrims and internally. And that's the only thing that is kind of leaving that question in my mind is you just had a really solid season with Acadian. Acadian's got more praise than he ever has in his career, really. Why is he not the starter anymore if Grig is not, you know, heavily outperforming him, or they internally don't feel that Grig is better, right? And that is the only thing kind of leaving me to feel like, you know, Grig is maybe going to be the better candidate.
All right, let's move on to Cloud9 then.
Okay.
You had them
third.
Third? What did you have them?
Third.
Third?
You had them second. Why are they second?
Because I think that Team Liquid is going to drop more games at the beginning. It was mostly about Team Liquid dropping more games and me putting Team Liquid lower. But I think that both Cloud9 and TSM are so hungry coming off of reverse sweeps.
Mm-hmm.
Like they have been practicing nonstop. The Cloud9 also has the deepest roster. Like they have amazing academy players. They have always, you know, trained up all this new talent. So I feel like they also coming into it, and especially with Reaper as head coach, always try out a few more like hidden strategies, you know, versus their academy teams, and with guys like Blabber and Golden Glue and stuff on the bench that could easily be starters on LCS teams. I think that they're gonna finish really strong.
They're gonna find the Sonateric at the start of week one.
The new Sonateric.
Yeah, whatever it is.
You me.
Let's not go there.
I mean, it's not shocking at all to say that C9 could finish, you know, second or even first, right? They were tied with record to TL in spring, right? The only reason that they were second place instead of first is because they lost the head-to-head. So, you know, I think it's totally conceivable for any of these three teams to be first. These teams were all very close. TSM, I think, had the slowest start of the three, but looked really good down the stretch. So, you know, these are three teams that should be competing for first place, and I think that's really, really exciting to have had that in spring and to have no major shakeups on these teams going into summer. And you know, the only reason we're really focusing more on TSM here is because they're the only team that really changed something, right? And that's why there's kind of more to talk about there. So maybe we can move on to some of the other teams that are kind of sticking out to you guys
over the rest of the league.
I'd say the next highest one I have that made changes is FlyQuest,
mm-hmm.
Bringing Wadeed. I do think that, because I've heard a lot about Wadeed's communication is really good. Like he talks a lot, and he did have success on G2. I know recently he had the complete opposite of success on Rogue, where that was literally the worst team. Yeah. Did they win any games? Actually,
they were 2-16 or 2-14, whatever.
Okay, so they won two games.
Yeah, they won two. So I remember I looked it up recently.
He's coming off a very rough split in Europe. So I'm not like super hyped about it, but I do think it is an interesting pickup because I know that is one of the things that FlyQuest was really looking to build on, was the communication aspect.
Yeah, I mean, I like Wadeed. It's just hard to get excited about this because I think JJ is mm-hmm. a pretty good player. Yeah. I understand that Wadeed's better, but like I never felt like the problem with FlyQuest that I have with like pushing them into the top three is not like a support position or communication. It's just like, you know, what a lot of people have always said, like raw carry potential. Like
You want star power.
I want star power. And like Wadeed and even the support position as a whole is not one where you're like, yes, now this guy is going to.
What about Core JJ? That's the star power.
That's star power. I'll give you that. But like if he wasn't, if you just put Core JJ on like Optic, I wouldn't be like, hey.
Really? That would be a great story. Reuniting with Crown, you know, they had to.
All right. I mean, not narratively.
Okay, what if he's bump. On? What if Core JJ is on FlyQuest? Are they in the top three?
Maybe. But like, I think Wadeed's not Core JJ. Yeah. So like, I think, you know, it's hard for me. I think they'll still be fourth. I have them fourth as well. Yeah. I think this is a good pickup. I have no problems with it. It's just like, it's doesn't have enough like wow factor, I guess, to make me be like to reconsider their standing in the league or like who this team is fundamentally. There's like not that big of a change from my outside opinion.
That's kind of how I'm looking at it too. I think it doesn't bump them into the top, like top three, but I think it does kind of solidify them as, you know, like mm-hmm. certainly going to be a playoff team. I think this is an improvement for the team. JJ was really solid, as you said, but FlyQuest was impressive. I mean, they were the only team outside of top three with an over 500 record, first of all, right? So, you know, as long as they are, you know, improving steadily, they are going to be solidly a playoff team. They should be able to compete. But I don't think that, you know, outside of the top three, like any team should be favored, you know, against those top guys. I think that, like, you know, in playoffs especially, it's going to be so incredibly hard to challenge them unless, you know, a team is improving by leaps and bounds throughout the regular season.
That's kind of an interesting topic. We've got our own gap in mm-hmm. the LCS, and all the players themselves were talking about it last split, and it was the top three versus the field, everybody else.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, FlyQuest and Golden Guardians felt maybe like the two closest contenders, Let's see, Golden Guardians, they added academy players, but I don't think they changed any main roster.
Yep. And who he joined, Darshan joined.
Yep. Who he has support.
Who he has support, which I think is really interesting too. You know, that's actually kind of exciting for me. And I mean, again, he's not on a team where they have like a really bad support or something where you think maybe he could get play time. But I kind of felt like when he you know, got replaced and he talked about potentially doing a role swap, support kind of makes sense. Because, you know, from everything that people talk about him, like, he is, you know, a very good player with communication. He's really good at checking cooldowns. He's really good at, like, a lot of those parts of the game. But, like, his laning and stuff has never been as strong. Uh-huh. I think there's less mechanical requirement for support than there is for a mid laner, certainly, right? So it'll be interesting to see if he can add a lot of value, you know, in that way. There are certainly some supports that do require, you know, like, heavy mechanics. But, like, you can play an entire season without anything being...
I think this is such an interesting discussion because people always, you know, people identify so strongly usually with their main role that there are always these discussions, and it started.
I'm a build player. I'm unbiased.
You're a top laner. You say that, but we all know what you are.
You're a filthy, you're a so filthy split push top laner.
It's not fraudulent. We know you better than you know yourself, bro.
Yeah, you'll play whatever, but like if you give Isaac some time and you're like, go climb, what is he playing?
Yeah,
top. You're playing top.
It's like when your buddy is like, yeah, you know, I play Yasuo and Riven and Talon, and we're like, yeah, but you're very bad.
What was that one?
Average. Average.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Average. Very bad on 2 out of 3 of those.
Yeah,
you're a one trick.
It's like when I said I could play Thresh when I played support. I couldn't.
Here's the difference. I don't say I can play any of the super complicated champions. I'm playing, in the roles that I'm bad at, I'm not like, yeah, I'm a Draven player when I play bot lane. Uh-huh. No, I'm playing some Caitlyn or some Tristana or whatever, you know?
But as far as the specific support versus mid laner one, I do feel like support can be super mechanically intensive, but just not in this carry-oriented mindset, right? So to me, one of the things I've been thinking about so much is like the different mindsets of the types of champions that you play and how you want to play through the game maybe is even a bigger difference than where you play the champion or what role, because we've had so much discussion with you know, perks moving from mid to bottom and stuff around this kind of topic, and with impact, you know, tanks, carries, side lanes. It's just like these different champions are classified by what lane they're played in rather than how they want to actually play in the game, you know, how you want to play team fights, how you want to actually operate. And I think that is probably the more precise restriction or description for these things.
So you're talking more about like mindset required, right?
Well, I think like, you know, the idea like Alistar is not the most complicated champion to play. And mechanically, like, yes, you can mess up his headbutt pulse combos or whatever, but like what makes a good Alistar is like finding the flank and like knowing how long to sit in that brush before it's a waste of time, and like how to roam effectively. And like the mechanical skill comes from your consistency in being able to execute like medium level skill plays, whereas like you're not playing Zed and have to manage like 3 shadows and figure out like the exact optimal outplay. So
that's
like
true. What about like,
so like
maybe Pyke?
I think Thresh is the most difficult
champion. Thresh definitely, yeah.
Yeah, like there's definitely hard mechanics, but it's I think a lot more.
We have another Yumi teaser here.
When are we going in on it?
Yeah, I mean, I was watching it. Wait for the who patch. Playing Yumi, actually. Okay. But I do think, to me, like I think you made a good point, because I think it's very much about mindset when you're playing different types of champions. When people brush, you know, tank players aside as, oh, well, tanks are easy to play because it's low mechanics. When I say support is like a lower mechanical thing than mid lane, I don't mean that it's easy to be a great support. I just mean that like that is something that you can excel in other areas and sometimes make up for it, right? It's the whole tanks versus carries thing. Like the best carry players sometimes are not good tank players, even though the mechanical requirement is so low, because they do not have a good understanding of the things that you need to be a great tank player, right? Mm-hmm. Of how much damage you can take. Should you be diving? Should you be peeling? When do you engage? Where do you engage? Do you need to be flanking? Do you need to be sitting on your carry? Like all these different things are different different skills that are not necessarily like super well displayed on the screen. You watch a fight. Yeah, okay, this guy ran in press W and that guy ran in press W, right? It looks the same.
Yeah.
Great, they're both good Maokai players, but it's about when they did it, where they did it, how they did it. And that is like why I think there's an enormous difference between different levels of tank players and how these guys play out team fights. And that isn't about mechanics, because you know, any of us three can execute any of the like Maokai mechanics required, about as complicated as it gets is dodging a skill shot with a W or knocking someone out of a dash with your Q, right? Yeah. This is not complex, but it's about where you are on the map and when you are doing your things. And that's why I think it's kind of cool to see, you know, the massive difference in play between two players playing a so-called easy champion, you know, where one can be one of the best players in the world and another could be, you know, hard stuck bronze or whatever, but you're both, you know, using the same mechanics.
To tie that back into Golden Guardians, because I agree with most of that, I'm not convinced that this is going to be a great role swap. I think like the idea of Huhi being a more team-oriented player has always been true, and he's a big playmaker and all that stuff. But like, I can't think of too many players like late in their career who make that swap and it goes super well. I guess like maybe Ambition, but even then he swapped in terms of how many years he was a pro player. It was like what, two or three mid versus like six. So who knows?
But it's also Academy. Right?
It's also like Academy.
It's just taking a shot. And if it works out really well, then great. It pays off.
Yeah. I think have to mention FBI for Jake, Spawn, Tiberio.
I wasn't even going to mention Jake, but
I wouldn't mention this without his pressure. So FBI is a very, very, very good Australian player.
Yeah, I thought so. I mean, he played in play-ins. He had at least one super hard carry game that I saw.
He got ranked 3 on the Korean ladder, I think Spawn was saying. Yep. So he's definitely up there. He's really good.
Yeah, I mean, Jake had been talking about him a lot, you know, and watching, you know, doing play-ins, watching him in OPL. He was extremely dominant. Watching him at play-ins, he was certainly like, you know, their team wasn't as good as some of the other teams, but he individually stood up. And Jake, you know, had been a big kind of supporter of him, talking about how he really does think that this guy has been LCS and LEC ready for a while, and that, you know, it just kind of needed to get that shot. So it'll be interesting to see if he can, you know, work his way up. Because I want to say was it Lost was the last
Lost was the guy that they got, the Echo Fox.
Yeah, Lost, but he only played you know a short amount of time when he came over. So it'll be interesting to see if FBI is actually able to really establish himself here, or if he will kind of wallow away in Academy. Because it's always kind of sad to me when you see these big talents come over and then it never really pans out for them. Levi was another example, you know, where I was so excited when he was coming over to the LCS. He never played a single LCS stage game, I don't believe, unless he played at Rift Rivals, but I don't think so.
No, because they had the import rule to deal with, so they never wanted to take out.
Yeah, they were messing around.
Another player, so it didn't really work out. I'm very excited though for the Golden Guardians one, because I feel like their bottom lane is a possible area where they would make changes. Mm-hmm. So that's why we're talking so much about their academy changes here. Because, you know, them adding Darshan, FBI, and Huhi, those are possibilities. I think Darshan's probably the lowest possibility of making it onto the LCS team, because I think Hunter was great, extremely good. So, but FBI probably has the highest chance for me for possibly making it.
They would need to swap Froggen or Ole out to get FBI on, right?
Yeah, well, what I was thinking they could do if Huhi and FBI are playing so much together, it would be a bottom lane switch. Yeah, because then Ole versus... Yeah,
so, I mean, that'd be really interesting, right? And we do have a recent example of a guy coming from a smaller region, Broken Blade, right? Like, Broken Blade has been absolutely incredible for TSM. So, you know, it's interesting, because I was having some of this discussion, you know, during play-ins with some of the people, and you know, a lot of the kind of coaches and analysts from some of these other regions really do strongly feel that while their teams are maybe not as good as some of the ones from the major regions, they do have individuals who are as good and who would thrive. And, you know, a lot of these guys are of the opinion that there should be more imports from the smaller regions than necessarily, you know, some of the major ones, because there are these kind of like untapped resources.
It's also funny that you use the term smaller region, because a lot of them are actually bigger.
Bigger player
Bigger player bases.
Well, I mean, smaller competitive scene, however you want to call it, emerging region, whatever.
But like the idea that more teams should be scouring the internets for untapped diamonds in the rough and in the emerging regions to put on, at the very least, an academy team like Golden Guardians is doing is exactly, I think, the right thing for North American teams, rather than just being like, big name player from Korea whose team just lost and is probably depressed, let's sign him.
Especially for Academy. I think it's a great way to use Academy, is to try players out like this and see if they if they fit, right? Academy to me should be you shooting your shots on unproven talents and seeing if they work out. And if it does, it can pay off big for you.
All right. I want to talk about another couple of changes then.
Okay.
Because CLG did add Ruin to replace Darshan, who went to the Golden Guardians Academy. And they I'm not quite sure if this is gonna be like the big change that the organization needed. Ruin was pretty good, but
has your faith returned, Kobe? Is that what you're talking about? Because we're still in the 4-5 position for the most part in our power rankings. Suddenly you're bringing CLG up. Do you have
I mean they finished what, seventh?
They finished seventh before.
So I mean,
are you having them in the playoffs with Ruin as the
We all have
BlackQuest GGS, I'm assuming.
We both have that. And then it's Echo Fox, CLG, Optic, Clutch, 100 Thieves.
Yeah.
I guess you can put forward. Okay, let's do it that way. Put forward of these last ones.
Your playoff team?
Your playoff team. That's actually a fun way to do it. Who's your playoff team out of the remaining one?
I have 100 Thieves.
Whoa! All the way from last place.
We're
Rocket,
doing it.
Rocket Mortgage up the.
They just signed Courage. JD,
the video is
really helped their League of Legends.
So I don't want to steal your CLG thunder if you have them. Who do you have?
I was just going down changes.
Oh, okay.
Go ahead on 100 Thieves because they also made some changes.
They made some changes. So they brought in Amazing for the jungle and Soligo, who was already playing a little bit at the end of the last split. For the most part, Soligo was like losing lane.
Doing okay though. Like, I thought he was like fairly even when he went up against like Bjergsen, he was like doing okay.
He was like low forward percentage and usually had like a pretty sizable CSD, like 10, but like he never died a ton. He was usually like stable in lane at the very least. It is very hard over the course of a full season to pick up a ton of wins if your mid laner is always down pressure. But I think if that means Amazing is doing a good job finally snowballing the side lanes, which is like what people have been waiting for forever for 100 Thieves to do, then like I don't think anyone believes that they lived up to their potential last split. No way in terms of talent should they be a 10th place roster. These are at worst side grades, right? And so like if they're fixing the synergy problems that they had, the communication, the attitude, maybe they're no longer being like, we're going to be a top three team, and then they lose four games and their mental goes boom. Because they were 4-4 at one point last split. Like they were not... Like, they lost so many games in a row at the end because it felt like they mental boomed. Mm-hmm. I feel like you can't mental boom when you're coming from a 10th place team and you know what you're signing up for.
You can still be mental boom.
You can still be mental boom, but it's not going to come out
Mark
of nowhere.
Mark is saying a lot of stuff right now, but I'm not really hearing, like, this is why they're going to be the playoff team.
Yumi's back for Afro.
I mean,
I'm kidding. I think they have a lot of hard carry potential in their side lanes, which a lot of the other teams are lacking.
Yeah.
That they're competing against. Like, with all due respect to a lot of these other guys, like, I don't think Biofrost and Stixxay and Ruin are better. I don't think Dokla and Arrow are better. And I think, like, they have better mid laners maybe. But, like, if Soligo can go even for the most part, even slightly behind, as long as he's not dying and can follow up on plays, I think this team does have the ability to turn around, not all the way back up to a top four team like we were all saying in spring, but at least into
in
the playoffs. Yeah.
The thing that's kind of interesting about it for me is it just depends on, like, so it's funny because you're like, oh, you know, when he predicts it, but this is a team that people had as top three in the spring and then they ended the 10th, right? So my concern is less, you know, like, can the players on paper, you know, perform, you know, if they're playing really well, could they be that? Yes, of course. You know, I think it is for me a question about the mental and if they're going to be able to fix their issues, because they looked like such a defeated team down the stretch. It looked like they were just giving up in games and not necessarily fighting for inhibitors. And, you know, like somebody would get massively ahead in lane and then they just kind of would just like sit in the side lane and never do anything. It was like, it was hard to watch.
Impossible to mental boom in 10th place. Mark just said it.
Yeah, which I'm disagreeing with. So.
Amazing joined the 10th place team. If they end up 10th, he's not going to be surprised.
I disagree with that too. So to me, it's kind of about like, you know, is Amazing joining the team enough of like that mental reset where everyone's like, great, everything's good again? Because you do kind of get that honeymoon phase sometimes when a new player comes in where everything is feeling good and fresh and you can do it. And, you know, and if they can kind of turn things around off that, then I think this could certainly be a playoff team, maybe even competing for higher than sixth. But coaching hasn't changed. And I think, you know, at the end of the day, a lot of what you're going to have to look at is going to be issues within how they were coaching the team and how it was handled. When you talk about mental boom, that is something that is, at the end of the day, responsibility of the coaching staff to be able to kind of handle and work through it and get this team to a place where they're still, you know, competing to the full potential that they have. And they never did that.
I kind of, how do you feel specifically about the change here? How do you think, as an individual, Amazing is going to do? Because he's been doing coaching and like analyst desk segments and stuff in Europe, and people aren't even really quite sure where he's going to land on the LCS stage. Even as a veteran, what are you thinking?
I'm hoping he has like a bit of that Meteos effect, and I think junglers in particular have that, where like you don't necessarily need to be like grind lording as hard in the jungle position. I think it's actually probably the easiest position to take breaks in and come back and like still have a good.
But it changes all the time.
It changes all the time, but like those are more cerebral changes than mechanical changes, I think, about like understanding like, okay, well, Scuttlecrab spawns a minute later now, so my path is this now, and this influences my ganks at these timings, and level two junglers aren't important. Like, it's less about like, oh my God, what? How's this champ work now? Which I think happens a lot in other positions when there's a big meta change. So I think, I'm hoping he's able to come back. He's always been, I think, a good player around playing around his lanes, which I think Onda was not very good at. Like, they really struggled to snowball top lane as much as they should have.
Yeah, I think they publicly said like one of the big issues was communication with jungle was one of the big reasons for the change.
Yeah, and, right, and like direct. Part of the problem is like two of them are Korean speakers, so like Amazing's not going to fix that probably. But at the very least, I think he conceptually understands what a laner might want more, because I think Onda was like good about efficiency and like pathing, but not necessarily like I'm going to do something inefficient to snowball lane. Interestingly, on Collegiate, if you didn't watch, I was talking with one of the junglers, and he was talking about how CKG is really good. He doesn't understand jungling, like pathing, but he's really good about getting his laners ahead because he used to be a laner. And he was talking about the differences that junglers have in those kind of skill sets. And I think that's hopefully something Amazing can bring, is like, you have strong side laners, get them ahead. Your efficiency is not as important for this team.
Yeah. I mean, one of the things that's always so interesting about jungle is that you need the holistic understanding of the entire game more so than every other role, because you have to understand every single matchup of all of your teammates, plus what you're doing, right?
Yeah.
Use that to navigate.
If you're blue side, it's like, I don't care if you cycle Krugs effectively. If I'm playing Jace and I need you to protect my wave, because if Jace gets ganked and killed, Jace is now useless. Like, a jungler needs to understand that more than anyone else. Mm-hmm. And I think, like, when someone is like, no, but my Krugs are up and I have to cycle Krugs because they're the most efficient camp, it's like, that's not how you win the game.
Yeah, or to be fair, you can have laners who can effectively explain that to you as long as you have
for sure.
But that's where communication becomes so important, right? If you can't communicate effectively with your teammates and you don't understand the matchup and they're not explaining it to you why it matters so much, then yeah, I think it's going to be pretty doomed.
All right, what about you, Azale? Who's getting your playoff spot?
Oh, man. It's actually really hard. I'm willing to bet on CLG just because I think – so, like, Ruin, I don't think is, like, you know, the next coming. I don't think he's going to absolutely dominate the league or anything like that. The real question to me is like, if CLG is going to kind of adapt their play style to how he played, or if he is going to adapt his play style to how, you know, CLG wants him to play. Because Ruin was very heavily a split push player. He's a carry style player, and he wins games by, like, playing side lanes almost entirely, right? Like, when you watch their finals, as well as a lot of in play-ins, you know, champions like Ryze were super high priority for him, and he's going to put himself ahead. He's going to prioritize getting his own farm, and he's going to win through, you know, side lane dominance. And I do think that it can be, you know, like a fairly effective style, and it's kind of what Darshan had been in the past. And I do think that individually, Ruin is going to be better than Darshan was. So, you know, if you have another strong lane there, like, that could, I think, spell good things for the team, you know, especially when, you know, you have, like, Power of Evil, who I still think is a very strong laner. If he has more pressure elsewhere on the map, then maybe he can do good things with that. I think the pitfall that could occur is if you try to take, you know, this split push guy and slap him on some tanks and say, all right, now you're playing weak side of the map every game, well, maybe that's not going to work. And the other risk is certainly, like, can CLG adapt to play more around those split push styles, right? So I think that is the big question for me. But I do think CLG was really close to actually making playoffs last time around. I still think Ruin is an upgrade over Darshan. And I think that, you know, these kind of clump of teams are all very close. And I do think that pickup could make a difference.
I think that the bot lane or bottom of the LCS is way harder to predict than the top for sure. And I think the thing that scares me for CLG is I'm not convinced that like Darshan was the problem specifically. Like I agree he was, you know, probably past his prime, one of the weaker top laners in the league, but like I don't see Rune.
They have a lot of issues.
They have a lot of issues as
much. All these teams do.
A lot of these teams do. I think for CLG, like some of their org left this offseason. I haven't heard any substantial additions to it. They were doing really weird drafts. They were swapping players around at pretty random times in the season. Like I personally still maintain that, like, I think it was their week 7 change tanked their chances at making playoffs. I thought they were a playoff team if they didn't make those changes. And like that's those kinds of decisions aren't maybe going anywhere. So I think Rune is not a significant of enough upgrade. And I think if the other teams also improve, like if Echo Fox, if Rush is not dying all the time in the first 4 weeks, you know, if he has a good split the entire time like we saw in the last couple weeks, like I think Echo Fox will still be above CLG and those kinds of things.
The Echo Fox and Clutch Gaming, I think both of those teams have a decent chance. I was having a really hard time making my case for Optic. I was trying to like make a case for each one of these teams, and I was like, Optic didn't make any changes, and I love their mid and jungle situation. And they even said that I think Meteos is more, it was like the full time now, right? Okay. So they have more like established, even though they still have Dardock on there, I think. But the side lanes for them, I feel pretty, like it's very difficult to predict them making it in without some changes going on the side lanes, I think.
Yeah, yeah, I think it is going to be tough. And I mean, for a lot of these teams, it's like the differences between these teams was very slight, right? Through, you know, 9-10 was like pretty far down. Top three was pretty far up. And then you had this like crunch of teams in the middle, you know, FlyQuest, Golden Guardians, Echo Fox, CLG, and Optic were all like two games apart from top to bottom, right? You know, CLG and Optic were one game behind Echo Fox. Like this is a matter of inches between these teams. And I think it is about, you know, who can make, like who has the most obvious things to improve upon. And that is, again, kind of, you know, what you're talking about with CLG is kind of almost something that, like, I'm assuming that they can recognize too, because I also agreed when they were swapping in their academy. So when they made the academy swaps, they lost almost every single game. I believe maybe they even did lose every single game.
I think
game
they were 0-4 or 0-5 or something with them.
Exactly, right?
And so they did it against weak opponents. They would lose against TSM and TL or something, and then go play Optic and then make their swap then. So it's like, those are when you need to pick up players.
Exactly. And I mean, they're 7-11. So you look at like 0-4, 0-5 with that against opponents that you maybe could have actually like.
I thought their 7-11 was going to be reference to.
Oh. So to me, it's like that is something where you hope that the coaching staff and you know, the management there like recognize that those were problems and they need to focus heavily on making playoffs. And if that is the case, that seems like the team was already capable of picking up a number more wins, which would have put them in playoffs. So, you know, that is something that is maybe an easy grab. You know, Clutch, Piglet is out and Cody's son is in. That is another
interesting one. I'm excited for the return of Cody.
Yeah, I mean, Cody's son, I think, is a guy that like really kind of just fell off the map. It was kind of weird to a lot of people when, you know, like he got essentially subbed out. He stopped being used, you know, even at Worlds and all these things, there was all the kind of drama with 100 Thieves. Then he was put on Clutch. You know, they stuck with Piglet pretty much the whole way through. Now it is back to Cody's son.
And even just as a play style, I think he works a lot better on Clutch, where you have like a very resource heavy top laner with Huni, and then Piglet also played super aggro, and so like if one of those lanes fell behind, usually like it's just so hard to win from that. I like Cody's son, who's a lot more passive in lane, which will allow them to focus on the top side hopefully, and then he's still a really competent good mid and late game team fighter. So like with Crit Marksman maybe coming back with some of the changes, like hopefully he can just chill out in the bot lane wall, top side of the map, makes all the plays in the early game, and then they go from there. So like I think this change does a lot of good for Clutch.
Yeah, I actually saw interview with Damante last week or something like that, and he was feeling like super confident. He was like, "Oh yeah, the scrims are going great. Huni's returning back to form." And I was like, "Oh,
who's stock you buying?"
Who's your six, by the way?
Always, I feel like our discussions with those teams are always like, "Is Huni coming back?" Yeah. Like we did that the whole split, right?
Because Hooney at his best is going to get you a lot of wins.
Yeah, and it didn't happen in spring, but I got excited again. So I was like, oh, no matter how many times it happens and it comes up not to be true, you're like, but Izzy, though.
Tails.
Yeah. Who you bet on, Kobe? Who's your number six?
I mean, I had CLG, but then you went with CLG. So
it doesn't mean you have to change.
You can have the same.
It's not taken.
Yeah, but it's not as interesting. So we don't have to explain
more.
We can
talk about other people. Like, who's your 10th? I bet we all have different 10ths.
Yeah, and we did touch on all of them. I think that I am going to take Echo Fox, actually, because Rick Fox just got out of Iron Four.
He's no longer the 98th ranked player.
Yeah, he got some advice from Double Lift and his son, and he's climbing just like the team is gonna climb into playoffs. How you like that answer, Jose?
I liked my own answer more when I wasn't even picking them about Rush doing better.
Yeah.
I think Echo Fox has a lot to improve on, even without needing roster changes. Just how different that team looked between the first half of spring and the second half of spring.
Yeah, and I mean, even if individual by individual, right?
Yeah,
we're talking about the Hooney thing. You know, when's he coming back or whatever? But the same question is all around Rush, right?
Mm-hmm.
There are these players that we have seen have success right in front of our eyes that did not perform last split, and the memories are still there, right? So the belief is definitely still there that there's a possibility for either of these guys.
Mm-hmm. Who's your 10th place teams? This is my favorite.
That's just a mean one. Like,
what? It's part of predicting.
All right, number 10.
Set. We can skip 7, 8, 9 if you guys want, or we can do all of them. I don't care.
It's just if there's other changes that you're kind of interested in with those teams, right? We've covered, I think, most of the.
It makes me sad, but I'm gonna throw Optic then.
That's mine actually too.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's actually what I had.
What?
Oh, okay, never mind. I thought it would be more interesting.
That makes it seem like it's a given, but I feel like there's
no. I think it's pretty much coin flip. Like, yeah. So I have my top 10 was CLG I had there, and then I had Echo Fox, Hunter Thieves, Clutch, Optic. But I really think that anywhere from 6th to 10th is like super up in the air,
mm-hmm.
and I don't feel like really confident about any of those spots. I think it's really hard to actually predict the bottom half of the table. Any of those five teams, I think, you know, because they're pretty close within striking distance, you know, if 100 Thieves performs better, them going from 10th to 6th is not a shock. I think it's similarly said, you know, with Clutch and with a lot of these teams, because it was small differences between them. The only reason that I really had Optic there is I just, like, for me, they didn't make any changes. It felt like it's maybe kind of weird to say, but I felt like they were performing at the level that they're going to be performing at, right? And I felt like there was more room for growth for some of these other teams.
It's hard to convince yourself why they would look better for spring.
Yeah.
And so, like, even though they weren't 10th last time, in fact, they were their 8th, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
I believe.
Because it was Echo Fox 6th.
It's tied for 7th.
Yeah, tied for 7th. So, like, if nothing changes and they're playing at their level, they could be 7th again. Yeah. But it's just, maybe it's a kind of bias where you're like, well, why would they get better? Like, CLG made a change, they should get better. Echo Fox should be performing better. 100 Thieves should be performing better. Clutch should be performing better. And so even if they play the same level and play 7th again, it's just like right now hard to justify.
I mean, the two teams that were under them in the standings last time, I think both did improve, you know.
Yeah, exactly.
And I have more faith in 100 Thieves. Like, I don't believe that they were a 10th place quality team. I think they should be getting better. I do think that like switching away from Piglet to Cody Sun should help.
Yep.
I think Clutch quite a bit. You know, CLG, I do think Rune is an upgrade over Darshan. Those are your three closest competitors. And, you know, and if those teams are all getting better, then you have to do something more. You have to do something special. And Optic felt like pretty even keel throughout the split. So unless they are really like improving individually and making some more like, you know, kind of individual changes, I think it can be kind of hard to keep pace because these teams were already very close.
All right, let's get into the patch then. How these teams are going to do right off the bat with 9-10. We actually skipped a couple patches since we last saw competitive, so a lot of things are going to be updated, not just 9-10, the Scuttle Crab. I know you guys were really big on the Aatrox changes. But as far as specifically 9-10, we've been alluding to Yuumi all show long. And I feel like after the hot fixes, she's in a fairly strong at least power level situation, right now, and I've talked to a bunch of pros, and actually they're pretty split on it as far as the people that I have talked to. Some of them still think she's not good. Some of them think that it's very strong now when you have the right composition to pair it with. Do you guys think it's going to be used in competitive? What are you feeling about the Yumi release?
So I think as far as Soul Q goes, I think it's just getting massively stronger the longer it's out, because like I've played some Yumi, I've played some against Yumi laning and you know just in the teams. I found one of the hardest things was even once I felt like I understood the champion, if my teammate, like who I'm laning with, doesn't understand it and doesn't understand that like my Q range is attached to them, they need to be, you know, like moving forward if the other team is moving back and these sorts of things. Like there's a lot of kind of coordination issues there. My biggest concern for Yumi for competitive play actually has nothing to do with the individual strength of the champion. It's how do you get vision as a Yumi player moving around on your own? How do you match roams as a Yumi player? And these sorts of things that are much less important in solo queue and are critically important in competitive play. It's the same reason that we have often, you know, asked the questions of like, oh, why isn't there more like Zyra or Brand or Vel'Koz or whatever? They're so good in lane, right? You know, they're so annoying. Look at all the sick poke they can do. And the answer is almost always, well, yeah, but what do you do past 10 minutes when you're supposed to be warding up around Dragon and these champions can't face check? It's so heavily why we see the Brahms and the Alistars and the Tahm Kench's, because you can walk up to a brush and not get one shot. Yumi starts the game with like 450 health or something like that. Like, you are so squishy. If you are not leashed to someone, you will die. And maybe there are adjustments that you can make where the jungler is just always paired up with you and you're always leashed to the jungler, and then you go around as a squad and get vision. But I still think that there's a lot of times in competitive play where you need to be able to make these solo ventures to match roams to mid lane, to be able to secure vision on your own. I think Yumi is really going to struggle to do that. If you can kind of get around that by playing super heavily with your jungler, then great. I think, you know, it has a lot of team fight presence. I think it's a fairly strong and annoying laner, or can be at times. But I just think that it's so risky to be played in the mid game. And I think that even for lane, some of the hard engage answers are there. Like I played Nautilus into this. It felt like an absolute joke. Like, it's if Yumi is fully attached to the person and not coming out for auto attacks and stuff, you just win the all in every time. And if she does unleash, she gets like one shot by some of these all in champions. It's I think, you know, a delicate balance.
So before we get into maybe some of the design of it, like just the I think it's going to be one of those a lot of people think it's strong right now in like warping scrim meta, but that's what I've heard, as well as some people saying, oh, they don't think it's that good. It feels like a lane focused champion, so it's no surprise that like in scrims it's gonna feel like a powerhouse, but on stage it might not. It was brought out a couple times in collegiate, it almost always looked good, but then they lost I think two out of the three games they played it, and so, you know, not like LCS is a level above collegiate, of course, but like I can see a world where people feel like it's really strong right now. People pick it a lot week one and week two, but they lose all the time with it before. It's like, oh, this is like Sona, Brand, all these other examples you're talking about, where like for the most part, they're annoying in lane, but once you get out of there, you're fine. What I think the other thing is, though, like you're saying, there's a lot more to be able to do. So like the strengths are in other areas, like the be able to take TP on your AD carry and get back to lane. You can also just take triple combat summoner. So one of the things I was hearing from pros was like, when you pick a Nautilus or something that should kill it in lane, if you don't win that first all-in attempt, which is hard to do versus triple combat summoner, you are then screwed the entire laning phase, because you got that turned around on you, your engage is down now, and then the rest of the laning phase she just sustains and pokes you out. So like I can see a world where she is, you know, so unique in the support position that like you can handle some of the mid game difficulties of vision control because you get these other advantages.
Yeah, I'm trying to keep an open mind on it, and whenever there are champions like this released, that's what I try and do. And because my initial reaction was, as soon as I saw the explanation of even just the first two abilities and her being like the Wisp or whatever that was, Dota, that's attached to people. Yeah. I was like, I absolutely hate that for competitive.
Wisp can be attacked though.
Exactly. But that's just the small parallel, right? You attach to people. And my initial reaction was, oh my God, I hate it. So I am going to keep my mind open, you know, especially for, you know, a first few weeks of how this can change, because it might be valuable to have something that's like, oh, this has to be lane power, and it changes the way you play the game, because you literally cannot roam around because you are walking money bag early game, and you have to coordinate with people to put you in their backpacks to take you around to the ward or whatever. But I, just looking at it, you know, from like a fairly far back view, was like, I really hate the idea of removing positioning and thought from one player in the game to be like in untargetable, attached to somebody, invincible, and then like you have to rely on the other person for your positioning. You take out some of the more interesting aspects of the game to me. It changes quite a few things, and it didn't feel to me like it added enough things in replacement. Her kit is like super high damage poke thing where she can basically guarantee it because it's just your mouse controlling or whatever. Yeah. And yeah, you have to worry about your
whoever you're on range.
Yeah. But other than that, it's just like you get stats and you get free heals and move speed and like a giant AoE damage. And so my initial reaction was I did not like it for competitive. I do see the value for having something like that for solo queue, for people playing with their friends. You want to bring newer people into the game and stuff like that. Like, I can see that for a social game. Makes a lot of sense. I think that they should heavily force balance this to be viable for low ELO and completely not viable for competitive.
Well, so the problem, I mean, not a designer, obviously.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I don't want to throw any shade, but like, it feels to me from what I see how the kit works from watching it in pro or the collegiate scene and just watching solo queue of it, like, I hope Isaac's Zale's concerns are right that like in competitive, yeah, it doesn't function because it's too dependent on teammates. Because if it is fine and competitive, there is no way it's balanced in solo queue. There's, because yep, the kit is actually very complicated. It's like you said, it's supposed to be designed for simple, maybe new players to the game. That seems to be like the goal, is like, this mm-hmm. is a fun thing anyone can pick up. The projectile just follows your mouse. It's really simple. You attach to someone, you just press E on them. It's hard to mess up, but it's actually super complicated to optimize correctly and all the intricacies of the kit.
That's what I was going to say, yeah.
Yeah, like popping in and off of someone at the right time and understanding how the internal cooldown resets, you can actually pop off someone, body block a skill shot, and then go back. Mm-hmm. You can pop off, and I've been told, I haven't tested it, you can disjoint a skill shot even, like if you buffer it correctly or something. I need to test that one. That could be wrong. But either way, like the trading pattern is actually complicated, where like you walk forward, get the auto attack off to get your shield and pop back with your W timing. And you want to pop your W timing correctly so you can disjoint and do that quickly. And like laning is actually really hard on this champion to do optimally.
Yeah, I don't see it as an easy champion. I think it's actually really complex. And all the things you're talking about just get more complex to do it at the highest level in a team fight, because now you're supposed to be doing this and bouncing around all the different members.
But
like, I mean, I do get the idea that like the lowest common level of play is I attach to you and now I will sit on you for the rest of the game, right? And like, if you're looking at it like that, but I think it's a pretty complex champion.
Right, so like, it's fine if the skill ceiling is low, but if the skill ceiling is also high and people can win at the high skill ceiling, then you have to nerf that, and then you're pushing the overall power of the champion down, unless you really kind of take away some of the more complex parts of the kit.
And that's what they would have to do, right? That is what the designers end up doing often when they're trying to push something out of pro and into solo queue. It's more about like, you know, nerfing some of like the highest skill aspect type things. I do think some of the unique strengths that Yuumi does have that can make it powerful is the fact, A, double combat summoners, which you mentioned, right? You don't need flash because you have W, you're normally attached to people. That is your escape. So you're using double combat summoners. You do not need to rush early boots. You can go incredibly squishy builds and not really care about that to have a lot of extra power. So things like Mage Eyes, if you're winning the game, can be incredibly effective, because if your team is ahead and you're winning every team fight, you should always have someone to attach to if you're playing it well to stay alive. I've been seeing a lot of people, you know, have a lot of success with things like, you know, Mage Eyes and an early Arden Sensor and these sorts of builds that have like no HP whatsoever in them and are pure squish, but they're very, very effective because you don't have to care about the fact that you can get one shot because you're always untargetable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, my problems for that on all these strengths are like, those are just super frustrating for the opponents. I guess my question is like, does it add enough of a positive of for the Yuumi, like hopping off, in and off people and, you know, the team working around, cat juggling, I guess. Cat
I feel like
is that adding you know, the positives that we want to see in competitive, because that was my initial reaction was I'd rather have it be a solo queue focused thing, mm-hmm. rather than see it
right, like Ryze is like a competitive champion where that ultimate is, mm-hmm. like no one in solo queue is going to use that, mm-hmm. like as a team, well, whereas like in pro it's like, wow, the teleport from pushing a lane to Baron is super strong, you know, like I hope Yumi ends up more and they'll like, this is really good for solo queue, like you said, it's good for newer players playing with, mm-hmm. friends maybe, if it is good and competitive, which is what I've heard from some people, and when I see the kit it looks complicated, I really hope that they push it back towards the solo queue realm, because like you're saying, I don't think it adds a ton for competitive, and if it's just really strong competitive, then it's not going to reach its goal of being a noob friendly champion, because its win rate has to be low because it's like crushing diamond or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, I'll be interested. I'm kind of reserving judgment until I actually get to see it on LCS stage, because I don't, you know, scrim results often don't mean it's.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Will people be willing to risk, you know, playing it, you know, for even the vision game? And it's also just so hard for me to really establish like strong opinions other than what I think as far as like the more meta stuff, like I'm talking about with vision, because both when I've played as it and when I've played against it, I have very little confidence that either side is playing it correctly.
Yeah.
Right. Because, because it's not just about like, oh, you know how to play Morgana well, right? It's you two both have to know how to play as Yumi. And that hasn't really happened. So like when I've played against it and slammed it, I'm like, you can probably beat this, but then when I hear, you know, some of the other thoughts of like, oh, triple combat summoners, and when you're, you know, disjointing skill shots and doing these things, I'm like, well, maybe my all-ins wouldn't work then, you know, like, so because it's so unlike what we have seen before in League, I really do think it needs some time to actually shake out at the highest level, and even for solo queue, for people to learn how to play as and against it, you know, not just as supports, but as the bot laners themselves.
I agree. I am concerned, but not pressing the panic button yet.
Yeah. I mean, I don't think... Yeah,
we have bans in competitive. Yeah. Worst case, it's OP. It gets banned red side every game. We've had that for all of League of Legends.
Yeah,
well, I mean, that's why we're saying keep an open mind, because you never should hit the panic button right at the beginning.
It's sometimes fun, though. Have you ever just freaked out?
Yeah,
and then...
that's what I'm saying, where he's like, I'm not going to have a strong opinion. It's fun to have a strong opinion.
No, it's...
As soon as you see
devil.
Stuff.
Well, I mean, I gave my strong opinion, but more just... I have been seeing some... very large, what I've considered to be overreaction.
Well, to which chat
of people saying Yumi is gonna ruin competitive and stuff, and I'm like, worst case, you just ban it every game.
I don't know if the general Reddit / Twitch chat community opinion is different, but like they think it's terrible. When it got picked in collegiate, you know, I would have Twitch chat up a little bit, and I would like look and see what people think. They're like, oh my god, they picked Yumi, they're trolling, and I'm like,
wait, you cast with Twitch chat up? That's crazy to me.
Sometimes, not like I'm not like staring at it.
He's trolling.
He is
trolling. Why is that trolling?
That's super trolling.
Why is it trolling?
Because you got to pay attention to the game.
It's pick ban.
You should be paying attention to your, your co-caster.
I don't know how long you think it, like, you don't have the mental capacity to, like, read a sentence or two.
Oh, he's going to turn around on us.
I am flaming you guys.
Yeah.
Come on.
We can't think through our pick and ban strategy.
No, we can't do that. Yeah. It's definitely more beneficial
to
look at all the Kappas in the Twitch chat.
I would argue it has value to see what the community perception of a champion lock-in is for the first time. Yeah, because if people think it's poo-poo and it's not poo-poo, I need to tell them that it's not poo-poo. So a large part of what I say,
hey, Bob Dole 33, you're wrong.
I didn't target
Bob Dole's in the Twitch chat.
Yeah.
Is that actual Bob Dole?
No, it's 33. It's just,
what happened to that guy? I don't even know. I'm just saying that, like, knowing what the community thinks allows you to cater what you're saying, so I could explain, like, the Yumi mechanics and what makes
you
strong.
You're just a Twitch chat shill.
That's all. I just want to be liked.
Okay.
I don't want to have strong opinions.
Yeah.
All right. We got some Twitter questions to say. I think you tweeted out before the show,
no,
maybe. Oh, you did it? Oh, I'm trolling you then.
Yeah.
My bad. I don't think we have any Twitter questions then.
More patch talk? Because we can talk about Ginsu's nerf.
I mean, we
Scuttle Crab change.
So I actually wanted to talk about...
Let me check, see if I got some questions.
I still wanted to talk about the Runic Echoes buff, because it's a significant gold buff to the AP jungle item. If you haven't seen, it's
cheaper.
It's still 910. But I already felt like at least Elise and Karthus, maybe Evelynn, which has shown up even already in some pro games before the buff, were super viable AP options. if we're going to have more AD laners and, you know, people diversify. But I'm actually pretty excited. With this buff, I definitely see strong resurgence of AP junglers. I hope that it's not a majority of Karthus, though, because I think that both Elise and Evelynn are a bit more interesting than the, you know, farm and
press R.
Ultimates coming down. But I do think that all three of those are going to be super viable now.
Well, I think also with the Ginsu's, or not, I don't want to say Ginsu's, the Scuttle Crab change should help all those junglers because they're all more three onwards. Yeah. The other two still are not really going to be contesting Scuttle Crab, but at least Elise will be a little easier to play potentially with that change. Champion pets also now apply the burn. Another Elise buff. The little
This is the tiniest change that I've seen to a jungle item ever.
Is Heimer viable now? Is that a pet?
Zyra jungle?
Yeah.
It's back.
Zyra might maybe be the biggest that, I don't know.
I played Zyra jungle when it first got changed to Morgana and Zyra a long time ago.
Yeah.
It never really picked up.
Yeah.
I think the Ginsu's one's pretty big from what I've heard is it's pushing crit marksman a little higher up. Mm. Like, it's not a straight nerf from like the 2 to 3 because you do get the 15% pen on it. But from what I've heard, like Varus, Kai'Sa, people are trying to find new builds, see if they're still good for the most part. Yeah. People are liking Zaya, Sivir, even some Caitlyn, like crit champion. So that could change the meta a little bit to be better for teams like probably Team Liquid and Clutch and like the more bot-oriented teams potentially or bot carry teams.
But yeah, I see a bit of bottom lane change and some influx of AP jungle, but that's about it. I think solo lanes stay very much the same for me. Like Akali, Aurelia, Sylas, these types of things are all still going to be super strong. I think those are still in there. And there were no changes to updates for Sona Taric as a strategy either. So I think that is still a possible, option down in the bottom lane, even with all the.
That's interesting because it didn't really work at MSI.
Yeah, I mean, I heard from a couple of players though that they at least still find it really annoying, which to me makes it sound like it's still strong for scrims at least.
Sona Taric or the
I could see it being.
I've been hearing some stuff about funnel too. Some people have.
I know that a lot of teams have been practicing.
They're practicing funnel. It. Yeah. I don't know if we'll see it or not, but that is one change that I'm not looking forward to. I'm hoping that it's at least not a dominant strategy.
Yeah. Well, what I heard was that it is not dominant.
Yeah.
However, it is definitely an option, and teams are practicing it. And so I'm actually not that upset. As much as I was like, I didn't really like funnel games. It being a strategy that is okay but slightly bad, I think is a good spot.
Yeah, I think Crumbs has been the one tweeting a lot about Leona Mordekaiser as a funnel strat mid.
Whatever. New Mord or old Mord?
Old Mord. And new Mord I don't think is on PBE yet. Might be, I don't know.
Okay.
Anyways, old Mord, Leona funnel with it because he gets the XP share and all that stuff. If that's like not a dominant strategy, but like, hey, you can maybe find a win against a better team than you because they're
sounds fun.
Yeah, like sure. I think kind of off meta strategy should be in the meta. As weird as that says, out of meta in the meta strategies.
This is the big brain looks at Twitch chat while casting. Yeah. So we might not be able to follow.
Well, to be fair,
explanation.
He's not able to look at Twitch chat during this. So
what opinion can I steal? Someone. But yeah, I think
I agree.
I don't like when the primary strategy in a meta is like it's Ardent Sensor, play it. And if you're not going to play it bot lane, put Ivern in your team comp. You need it. You know, like I didn't like that meta. I like when there's more creativity.
Yeah. And to be fair, I think at MSI, we had a lot of that, right? We actually did have diverging strategies. If some funnel is thrown in the mix, I'm totally happy with that. But I'm definitely excited for the season to get going and to see, you know, how wrong we are about some of these predictions. But it should be a lot of fun. I think, you know, having some changes at the bottom of the table makes a lot of those teams exciting to watch again to see how it's actually going to shake out. I'm so excited to see how the top three are going to be performing. You know, them fighting, going towards Rift Rivals, going towards Worlds. I'm actually really, really excited to see how well they're performing because I feel more invested in the success of those top three teams in the early season than otherwise because I want to see them representing well at Rift Rivals.
Yeah, we're coming back to summer, I feel like, with such a crazy amount of hype because, like I said before, like, you know, Team Liquid doing that well on the international stage just made me feel really like proud. I like we have three titans ready to clash here in summer and everyone's gonna follow. Oh my god, they dropped a game to this team. Oh no, what's going wrong? They're gonna
I mean, even if one of them doesn't make it to Worlds, that means like this other team came up and you know, took over that position. So I'm really excited too that we're actually not just like, these changes are crazy, hopefully we're good. It's like, we are good. Now let's see who gets to get to the top of the pyramid. Yeah.
All right, that is going to do it for this episode of The Dive. Join us for summer. We're going to have Team Liquid versus TSM on Saturday.
Right.
The show with Countdown starts at 1:30, so tune in then.
Well, back to the original question. So, like, the mid lanes that are more, like, situated on playing what's meta, like, if you got a chance to talk to Faker, would that advice you would give him? Because he used to play weird ass stuff like Master Yi. But
wait a minute. So it's Caps is just that. So now he's beating him just once. No. He's turning around like, all right, Faker, come here, son. I'll teach you a thing about League of Legends, right? Shut up. And what you want to do in the mid lane, son, is someone get a translator in here. Like,
okay, let's go. Tragic accident angle. Like, tragic accident happened. Caps injured his hands, and then for some reason he got imported to Korea, and now he's the SKT coach. Is that a direction you would give Faker? Right. Would you tell Faker like, to play these other champions and to be more confident?
Right, this is going to be episode 57 of Listen Lowcore. And even though on the last episode, we technically did the episode where it's after the tournament and we review it all, etc., Lowcore did one of those classic ones where he brings on someone who just lost a massive match, so we can't really go as fucking hard. We don't even analyze the game as much. Just softball, softball, softball. They just hit him out the park, and then he goes, oh, brilliant. It's easy doing the show thing. Travis, when are we going to collab? I do what you do. It's like, so anyway, I stepped into the breach, and I was like, I can't let this stand. Rather than just bring on someone who's a friend of Lowcore's, let's actually bring on some real players, shall we? People who actually know what the fuck they're doing in this game, Lowcore. So, as usual, you can tell the difference between when Lowcore books the guests and when I book the guests. Lowcore will get someone who just lost in like the fucking quarterfinals of the LCS and be like, ah, let's have a great chat. I just get probably like, you know, some people might say the best League of Legends player in the entire world, Lowcore. So, you know, anytime you want to reply and get Faker or something, just, you know, go ahead. Ball's in your court, son. So anyway, welcome Caps to the show here, formerly of Fnatic. Not that they want to remember that, but now of G2, MSI champion, pretty good. So actually, let's start there, Caps, because even though obviously, yes, we want to get to all the MSI stuff, I haven't seen actually, because during the split, a lot of the focus was on G2 as a team. Can you give us some more insight into the stuff in the off season? Like when you came out, when you first made the move to G2 and you said like, you know, this is just who I am. You know, I like to do kind of like crazy moves sometimes. I like challenges and stuff. What was the thinking in your mind? Why did you want to go to G2? Because, you know, to a lot of people, to even make the final of Worlds is like an unthinkable dream for some Western players. You know, there's some players who've never, obviously none of them had ever been that far before. So why leave a team like Fnatic that looked like you could have done so much more there?
Well, I mean, I think going into the off season, it was my first off season, like where I was basically, like before I just knew I was going to join Fnatic, right? But it was my first off season, and I wanted to basically look at my options, and I did not really like have any particular idea, as to what I wanted, but I was definitely like open-minded going into the off season, and I was talking with like a lot of different teams. I was talking with like, I mean, both NA and EU teams. Didn't really know what I wanted, and basically just when I heard this G2 lineup, I just kind of clicked. Like I just thought it sounds really interesting. I mean, obviously I have always had a lot of respect for Perks. I think he's like one of the players that was not on my team that I talked with, just because he made it very far internationally, and we would like talk together.
Plus, you had that group.
Well, I mean, okay. I mean, yeah. I mean, more like we just like discussed matchups and stuff, right?
But of course.
but sure. And then other than that, I also knew that because I was talking with a lot of teams, I knew that Miki was like really highly rated by a lot of teams, and
sure.
I don't want to be like a guy who, I mean, I'm not super good at like rating everyone. I don't know exactly who's like the best in other roles. Like I always find it hard, right? I know how good I think my teammates are, and other than that, it's hard to rate everyone else. But everyone was rating Miki really high, so I had a lot of like respect for him in that sense. And I was basically talking with him about like what he wanted to do, and he was really keen on the G2 lineup. And other than that, I mean, I thought Jankos was a really good jungle. And while I think he was really underrated during like, I mean, basically all of last year, I think even now he's still really underrated. And then Wonder, I mean, I didn't really have like, I mean, I had fine expectations for Wonder. I thought he would be good, but I didn't think he would be as good as he actually turned out to be. So that was like a nice surprise for me.
Was there
by the way, since just so we can get this, like since I saw that it was eventually implied, this came out later, that like Cloud9 was one of the teams trying to get you because obviously they lost Jensen over to Team Liquid. Was that ever actually something that could have happened? Like, was that, would you ever have gone to NA? Was that something you would seriously entertain, or was that just like an offer that's cool, but you didn't really think about it?
I mean, like going into the offseason, I was wanted to be really open-minded. Like, I just want to talk with every team, basically. But then suddenly it turned out that there was like a lot of teams that were changing mid lane in last offseason. So I was like trying to cut it down. And I mean, at some point I just decided that NA is not something I want to do this next split. So I kind of cut off NA like at some point. And then I was like talking with basically like, I guess it kind of ended up deciding between like Fnatic and G2 mostly. And then there was like one more EU team that I was like thinking about. But other than that, there's definitely a world in which I went NA, but I just think that the teams in the EU I had would be stronger. Mm.
So for 2018 Worlds, like you had a good performance, but Perks also had a really good performance as mid. Was there ever a discussion between two of you guys who would play mid? Like even if you guys are playing on the same team, was there a discussion if you would play AD, if he would play mid, or was it from the start that you would be mid, he would be AD carry?
Yeah, I mean, I think when I started talking with G2 and the players and stuff like this, and I was talking about Perks and like he wanted to reroll suddenly and stuff like this, I was definitely thinking like, wait, do I want to reroll? Like I was like, maybe I actually want to reroll, you know? And I was starting to have this idea as well, but I think it was kind of just Perks from the beginning. There was definitely times where I thought, wait, like, are we doing like some sort of like mix where I'm like gonna play AD as well? Because I was like in the offseason,
because you're gonna share it or something.
Yeah, I mean, like, I was also like kind of enjoying AD, you know? For example, at All Stars, I was also playing like the AD at like some of the games, and it was like kind of fun, you know? So I was not really sure what to expect, but I think Perks just wants to reroll to AD, so we just kind of went for that, right?
Okay,
what about this then? Another thing that's interesting is by now, obviously, after MSI and the final of the LEC, everyone's seen some of the really unusual picks and compositions that G2's been willing to run. I mean, obviously, Game 5 against SK Telecom, like that would be unthinkable in the past for a team to do something like that in a Game 5. So one of the things that's been interesting is I noticed whenever Ocelot and Grabs talk about that, they make it very clear that like that was something that in theory was on the table from the beginning. It's like if you guys want to do something or pick something or try something, they're very open to it. It's not like the coaching staff like, you know, we're going to tell you how to play and you do exactly this and here's the champions you play and you get a choice of three of them and you pick which of the three. What would you say about that? What is the culture like at G2 and is it different from when you're in Fnatic?
I mean, I think like the first thing Ocelot said to me was like, I mean, not this first, but like one of the first things he said to me and the team was like, I just want you guys to have fun with the game, basically. And I mean, I thought it was like, I mean, I don't want to say that I thought it was like weird because, I mean, obviously I want to have fun, but I also want to win, right? Mm-hmm. But it's just like this idea of like kind of like a brotherhood, you know? Like everyone on our team has a lot of experience. Everyone on our team like played so many games and been in like so many weird situations that we realized that it's not always the best to just go for the standard way, and we also have a lot of confidence in each other because we've seen each other. Like obviously Miki has lost to the Vayne mid himself, right? And and other than that, we've all been playing like some sort of weird things, and we just have a lot of respect for each other and think that basically we just trust that, like, I trust, for example, Wonder will pull out the Pyke top, right? And make it work. And I think what happens in a lot of teams is that sure, sometimes people are confident in themselves trying out things, but people are not confident in each other's teammates trying out things. And you just want your teammate, like if let's say we have the Pyke, right? Like a lot of people just say, like, I don't want the Pyke top of my team, I want like a Maokai in my team, you know? And we just have a lot of faith in our teammates that they will just pull it out and actually make it work.
So what happens in the case where it goes disastrous? What about like that Vayne Akali matchup? Like what's kind of the aftermath?
I mean, we basically just like kind of laugh it off, I would say. We obviously like try to like no one gets like, it's not like Wonder suddenly gets mad and we're like saying, oh, maybe we shouldn't like trust Wonder anymore. It's just like kind of like, this is not like a good matchup. Like I don't really know why we end up in that matchup, and I think everyone kind of agrees. It doesn't like it depends on the situation. Like sometimes it just means like, oh, okay, let's just not play this champion anymore. Obviously we also had other champs. It doesn't have to be like something crazy as Vayne. It could also just be like the Corki or the Vlad or the RC I played, which all things didn't really work out, and then we just try to adapt, right, and make something happen that instead works.
Sure. So one of the topics coming into MSI was obviously people didn't know whether Mickey would actually be able to play at all or whether he'd be able to practice for the tournament. And, you know, obviously Promiscu was there in case he needed to step in. Like, how much actual practice were you able to get with Mickey X in the team?
Love. taste of fear. When the henchmen call, I am Fister Chamberlain. I am Fister claiming all. Head of the king, head of the world, kneel to the crown, stand in the sun. Head of the king.
sick of this pity within me. I'm ready to get up and hit it with all I got out of the parking lot. Even if I'ma not get it right when I went running a marathon, struggling, carrying buckets of tears to replenish the fear. I wanna be there with the fire and venom, come on with the element, shine with the rest of them, rise like a phoenix and nine. The demons are trying to keep me from living my vision. Stripping it all off, all these chains that I made, it's all on me, cause I maybe could away my way of knowing that power that burning in all us. I can feel it now, swelling in my stomach, hear it. Screaming in anger, raging bulldog, don't give a damn, get kick on. Like that something inside me running to catch that objective. I panic, intimidated, that figure. Why you leaving? I'm just another figure striving to make an effort. Get so frantic, nature shaking my stature, and I gotta let it.
Sometimes I feel lost and locked up in the jail cell in my mind, and I try to understand the situation, see eye to eye. But sometimes I feel lost and locked up in the jail cell in my mind, and I try to understand the situation, see eye to eye.
I see my freedom and visions, get up to speed to living. I supersede the defeat like a teacher speaking wisdom. Get down to business and handle this shit we trample. Everyone just trying to manage within comes that evil twin to preaching. We in a billion of little shimmering chameleons who cover up our existence. Seems like no one gonna make a difference. Come back, just look at the picture different, recap. Forget the limits, keep crushing them boulders, take that. Some moments come up to make me look in the mirror, knock sense of my fear of drowning, surrounded by evil stares. It goes. Say goodbye to all that poison inside, within the evil eyes, see an endless pit of demise. I'm sick of the judging, it's nothing but hate in disguise. So much assuming the worst while its truth is denied. The power resides to the one questioning why, and the one who confides and admits to the crime.
Sometimes I feel lost and locked up in the jail cell in my mind, and I try to understand the situation, see eye to eye. But sometimes I feel lost and locked up in the jail cell in my mind, and I try to understand the situation, see eye to eye.
Sometimes
I'm Mike Chipos, man. I got this, yeah.
I really got a dream. 10 years for the hustle, 10 years for the pain, 10 years for the struggle, and I'll do with a game. Had to find my own hustle, had to find my own lane, being broke with a joke. Fight back DNA, come on. Already gotta put it down with the flow, put it down with the flow. When you really gotta feel me, already gotta put it down with the flow, put it down with the flow. When I gotta keep a roachy, already gotta keep it down. down with the flow, keep it down with the flow. When you really gotta know that, already gotta put it down with the flow, put it down with the flow. When I really gotta show that, for time to work, when it's time to grind, yeah. When it's time to shine the beat, when it's time to grind for eh. Talk to when shit was hard to work, when it's time to grind, yeah. Now listen, listen, man, you ain't down for my dreams, you know you, eh. Talk to him, come on. Everybody grows up, everybody changes. Everybody grows up, some are stuck in the maze. And we all got big dreams, and we hope that it pays. So you gotta fix your mind up, and get out of the maze. What you know about that, G?
Do it yourself.
You see, most people have sight, but not everybody got vision. I'ma say again, most people have sight, but not everybody got vision. Do it yourself. And I ain't down with the foolery. And I ain't down with the jewelry. And I ain't down with the coonery. Everybody wanna talk how they're ruling me. Everybody wanna talk about the jewelry. Everybody wanna talk how they're fooling me. Everybody wanna talk how they're schooling me. Deep boy, child ruling me. Cause I was always trying to shine, I was always on grind, now the people wanna bother me. And I was always trying to shine, I was always online, now the people wanna follow me. And I was always trying to rhyme, I was always trying to grind, now the people wanna honor me. You want a friend, you a foe, only care about the dough, so please don't bother me. For time to work, when it's time to grind, it ain't. When it's time to shine the beat, when it's time to grind for eh. Talk to him, wet shit was hard to work. When it's time to grind, it ain't. Say what? Say what? I pour a load in my hustle, I pour a load in my name, I pour a load in my struggle, I never put it in the game. I pour a load in my dream, I never put it in the team, I never put it in the team. Real brothers know what I mean, I talk to him, come on. You weren't by my side, he weren't by my side, she weren't by my side, you weren't by my side, they weren't by my side, you weren't by my side. Now go, no, no, you weren't by my side, but everybody said it down the ride, I talk to him, hey. I have with my plan, I pray hard, I hope you guys understand, but they don't hear me though. Sometimes I feel I'm going crazy, but if I don't do my brain, then I really won't make it. Sometimes I'm feeling kind of lazy, but boy, I know I gotta do it myself, cause I'll be grinding in the rain, sun, snow, cause I'll be grinding in the rain, sun, snow. Down in me though. Sometimes I feel I'm going crazy, but if I don't do my brain, then I really won't make it. Sometimes I'm feeling kind of lazy, but boy, I know I gotta do it myself, cause I'll be grinding in the rain, sun.
On a scale of 1 to America, how free are you tonight?
Four walls where I wanna stay. Yes, I'd like something from the menu. Menu. Still got it.
Oh God.
Now I want to breathe.
'cause I cannot see what you can see so easily. I thought my demons were almost defeated, but you took the side and you pulled them to freedom. They know my secrets and won't let me go.
Never die when the world is calling you. Can you hear them screaming out your name? Legends never die, they become a part of you. Every time you play for reaching greatness, relentless, you survive.
I wanted to try this again. I wanted to try this one more time. Maybe cause I've been damaged. Maybe cause I've been fucking blind. And all of this lust and romance. All I need's a win. I shouldn't have tried this again. Yeah, I shouldn't have tried this one more time. So go on and do your damage. Go on and twist your rusted knife. Leave me dead and loveless. All I need's a win.
Yeah. All right. April 16th. Taxes are done. IRS is happy with you personally, not with me personally. With us as people, probably not. You filled out your census? No, you didn't. Okay. Well, you're going to jail. Everybody's sick. And there's a new singer on the chorus whose name I can't mention. Here we go. You could tell my attitude was way different than them dudes trying to rap at you. Cause half them dudes would use the same platitudes, thinking this is gonna get the girl laughing soon. Not true, homeboy, but I like the entertainment. You threw so much money that I thought that it was raining, and so did like 15 other guys. Go try the other side. Crazy Town Live playing Butterfly. Pit stained Ed Hardy shirts. Yeah, them dudes don't like me, it hardly hurts. I just go home, rip another gnarly verse. Think about the pretty girl with the darling purse. And when these thoughts get conjured, they run the gamut. From how she looks naked to chilling in the mansion, cause that's a lot to handle. We scramble all around Hamden, Cunningham, Randall. No throwback on, you like throwback songs. Karaoke with the vocab gone. Next morning, wake up, turn right back on. Same clothes that last night, living life like poems. And we still look good when we head to brunch. No pomade, but my hair standing up. Walking to the restaurant, getting stairs and such. But it's all good, let them suckers glare at us. Cause they
sitting on the sidelines, you follow all the guidelines. You wait your turn and follow rules. I live like
back, so now we back on. Drop a little hint about a track to rap on. don't hate suggestions, but you suggested a lot of stock in you, so I'm quite invested. You piqued my interest, my yields are sky high. Thoughts of grandeur, we playing for my ties. Damn, we eye fly, easy to hate this. Jealousy's tough, we don't speak that language, but we go so hard with our thumbs up. Dumb luck, no, taught ourselves how to get where to go, and we go until we get there. Owen on a jet land, not yet, but imagination's how we get there. Heck yeah, fist up, you can do your fist pump. I don't have time, cause the grind gets a bit tough. Go Jersey Shore, show you the door. Drop shit you never heard before, because I'm peddling my gift, ain't settling for shit. Every week something new and it's steadily legit. Readily will pedal cause my scooter doesn't fit. Can't coast, no joke, 27 different shifts. Working for a dick is just something I don't get. So I'm doing what I love and avoiding politics. Knowledge and a gift and a drive that doesn't shift. I could never be in park, I ain't flying on a whim. Riding on a hymn, you can tie me to a sin. I am cutthroat, Jesus couldn't help me if he lived. Back and forth motion, I ain't fucking till I jizz. I don't mean to be explicit, that's how it really is. And I can't stop, this is all there is now. If you like some other guy, go and rock his sound. I can always get down, shit can't faze me. Put your fucking fist up, this is Black Paisley. And I'm done, I'm fucking done. I am just off of it, I'm off of it, I'm off of it. I'm done, I'm fucking off of it. You all of it, y'all all of it. Y'all all can live, alternates. No sitting on the bench, fuck all that shit. No sidelines, no sidelines, no sidelines, no sidelines. Not for me, not anymore, not for me, no, not anymore. Fuck the B team, we're the A team. If you used to be on the B team, now you can hop up on the A team. Because you fucking, fucking, fucking awesome.
Facebook.com/EW Hip Hop, Twitter.com/EW Hip Hop. See you guys later.
Save our in nomine. turn up till my nose bleed. I blacked out in the black car. I was trying to feel like a rock star, but I can't just do one now. No, I've been way too numb now. I'm living on the run now. Oh, I gotta get out of this town somehow, 'cause the bad's been slowly getting worse in this fast lane. Living is a curse, better tell me, what's your life worth? I think it's time for a change, 'cause the bad's been slowly getting worse in this fast lane. Living is a curse, better tell me, what's your life worth? I think it's time for a change, 'cause the drugs don't work anymore. Find the thrill again. I couldn't seem to kill the pain. I was living in the moment, searching for a little serotonin. But this shit ain't so fun now. I can't deal with the calm down. I've been living on the run now. Oh, I gotta get out of this town somehow, 'cause the bad's been slowly getting worse in this fast lane. Better tell me, what's your life worth? I think it's time for a change, 'cause the bad's been slowly getting worse in this fast lane. Living it's a curse, better tell me, what's your life worth? I think it's time for a change, 'cause the drugs don't work anymore. Thrill again. I
couldn't seem to kill the pain. I was living in the moment, searching for a little serotonin. But this shit ain't so fun now. I can't deal with the calm down. I've been living on the run now. Oh, I gotta get out of this town somehow. Cause the bad's been slowly getting worse in this fast lane. Better tell me, what's your life worth? I think it's time for a change. Cause the bad's been slowly getting worse in this fast lane. Living it's a curse. Better tell me, what's your life worth? I think it's time for a change. Cause the drugs don't work anymore.
Anyone to suffer in pain anymore.
In the 60s, make love and make war. So I went off, I made the war, and then after I made the love, I had the wife and the six children, as I told you about. So making love's tougher than making war. Making war's a lot easier.
Like it's suffering from strangulation, tears flying out of my eyes, my heart racing and my hands shaking. The last days of your life as a cancer patient, I'm staring at your corpse, praying and waiting for you to awaken. 21 gun salute for the hero, the burial was beautiful. Both three berets and screaming eagles attended the funeral. I was mad at God like he murdered you. As a father, you couldn't have done a better job. All six of your children basically worshipped you. If I need advice, I always came to you to discuss it. You was the only person since the day I was born I ever trusted. Through poverty, death, disease, and sickness, you'd always somehow find a way to turn the situation optimistic. I was a big fat kid, overweight, so to clown me, you bought me the Fat Boys. It was my very first rap tape. In the neighborhood, you had a name, you was feared and respected. Other fathers walked out on their kids and left them neglected. My only regret about not selling out and getting richer is that if I made millions, I could have shared it and spent it with you. I miss you. I love you, Daddy. Samaritan, part criminal, a master with weapons, nice with his hands. He was rugged man, the original. As children, we saw you losing your sanity. Even though we watched you struggle financially, you kept the love in the family. Daddy, I'm thinking about you every day, though. I could see you holding a machine gun in heaven with angel wings and a halo. You was always quick to pick a pocket. You the only one in heaven, probably slick enough to pull off stealing God's wallet. In life, the Lord ain't really dear you a fair one. I watched you bury your baby boy, your daughter, and your grandson. You lived one hell of a life, from being highly decorated to being homeless, sleeping in the park with your pregnant wife. If I I acted up in the restaurant, I knew I was being brave. Cause you take me to the bathroom and spank me till I knew how to behave. Taught me prayers at night and you tell me Bible stories. Taught me history, Crazy Horse and his tribal glories. How many times as a kid I seen you handcuffed by the cops? You taught us black music, Sam Cooke, the Drifters, the Four Tops. Taught me about boxing, Ray Leonard and Larry Holmes. Around the same time you left my mother for Debbie Jones. I told the world your true story and after the record got made, Uncommon Valor, some said I dropped the verse of the decade. Everywhere you went you tell the world about your son, Rugged Man. You was so proud of me, daddy, you was my number one fan. You was always bragging about me to no purpose. On your deathbed you was playing my Mayweather interview for the nurses. Losing you, daddy, it hurt more than any physical pain. You was too young when the cancer went from your throat and into your brain. You was my teacher, my idol, I worshipped you. Well, you was the best, daddy. You lived a tough life, now get some rest, daddy. I love you, daddy.
Send me on my way. Release me to this earth within this shallow grave. Grave digger, grave digger, bring me to my knee. Forget what I have done, forgive me if you please. Save me if you can. The time for me has come. Let me be the one that got away. Grave digger, grave digger, slowly fill my grave. Whisper to your God, allow me to be saved. Grave digger, pray for my lost soul. Release me from this earth, allow me to grow old. Save me if you can, the time for me has come. Let me be the one that got away.
That's tell about a thugged out homie I know so well. It started way back when I was a teen, in the hood on the corner slanging dope to fiends. Had a little stash that could serve your need. You can do what you want, but I got weed for me. Riding for my fam, trying to hit the grand crash unit on my ass, now I'm in demand. One lonely family I be, all in the hood, I got nobody. The sun is beating down on my red golf hat. Pigs are roaming through the alley, so I gotta toss my cat. Forgot about the sack, looking for a place to hide. If they ask me for my name, fuck them, I'm a lie. One OG gangsta I be, busted in the hood, I got no more weed. Things are coming down on my gangsta stash, when they caught me with the weed and the dope and hash. He said a little something, I wasn't so impressed. No more running, homie, now you're under arrest. The sack was in my hand, felt like a sack of bricks. I swore he couldn't see it when I threw it in my whip. He said he wanted some, I said I don't have none. Found it in the sun, on the floor next to my gun. Next thing I saw were the guns to my head. Now the lead will make me dead, and yo, this is what he said.
My name is Sergeant Slacker with a license to kill. I think you know what time it is, it's time to get real. Now what do we have here? A banger and his peers.
He cut my hand, you understand, he threatened me with tears. Sorry, motherfucker, had his gun out with a grin. You think the story's over, but it's ready to begin.
One OG gangster I be, busted in the hood, I got no more weed. Things are coming down on my gangster stash, when they caught me with the weed and the dope and hash. Now I got your crack and most of your crew. You got a couple choices of what you can do. Better make the right decision if you know what I mean. You can't do some time or fork over your green.
I said I got no green, he started looking at me harder. I said I don't have nothing, you can go fuck your daughter. He hit me with the fist, he hit me with the gat. He put the nightstick to my back. Damn. So I think I'm done, the pig's got my gun. It isn't looking good, I got ink on my thumb. Another pig walked in, said he's playing games. He gave another look at me, found out my false name.
One OG gangster I be, busted in the hood, I got no more weed. Pigs are coming down on my gangster stash, when they caught me with the weed and the dope and hash.
Sitting there pissed as I dwell in my cell. The place smells like shit in the county jail. Homie looking at me like he seen me before. He started throwing up a set, then he spit on the floor. I think, hey, yeah, yo, I know this kid. It's the same motherfucker cocktail my crib. This dude said, get ready, pulled the shank on me. I said, come on, homie, you a bit too sloppy. Fool tried to stab me, socked him in the eye. The guards yelled, give it up, and let two fly. The guards sat down and we hit the floor. If you make a move after, you won't move no more. He said, I see you once again, best protect your neck. I said, eat a dick from me, you don't get respect. I said, you wanna come with it anytime and place, and I'll leave you like Pacino with a scar on your face. They put him in the hole, and all the bullshit stopped. But when this boy had beef, yeah, he got dropped. PD had no witness, DA dropped the load. I got probation for the gun and the dope case closed.
One OG gangster I be, busted in the hood, I got no more weed. Pigs are coming down on my gangster stash, when they caught me with the weed and the dope and hash. One OG gangster I be, busted in the hood, I got no more weed. Pigs are coming down on my gangster stash, when they caught me with the weed and the dope and hash.
I spark like a blunt's tip, something cavy, making green like Mitch. Gift rap vocals dispatch with every attempt to have this gang shook up. When Dre cook up, every thug look up. Grinding got me on chill, eyes bloodshot, heavy built. Lay a nigga out like Quill. Clear the gimp, I rock for rollers, from low riders to Henny toasters. Cut off dead weight to keep my formulas kosher. Accept no imitation, straight losing his stack. It's slimmest chances of Michael Jackson getting his black fans back. My reputation's like a Tech Nine, knock out the best in the circle. 3 minutes wreck time.
We're pulling strings, killing kings, cutting old pinky rings. Seizing control of the whole game. I took a pull from the blood, inhaled and blew the smoke from my lungs into the world of hip hop. Civilians turn into soldiers by the millions. Assassins, we multiply by the masses. Masters of the game, every move you make. Through manipulation is the move I choose for you to take. You see what I want you to see, and you turn into whatever I want you to be. Whether it be enemy or ally, the aftermath results in soul assassins worldwide.
I'm by the hood, raised by the wood, trained by the pain, adopted by gorillas, got a tank for a car, ice for arm, got tattoos for skin.
in and stars for balls. Got a building for a crib, Manhattan for a backyard, skyscraper neighbors, and fuck me when they man gone. Kings of New York, I'm one of the few of those. Difficulties occur, it's gonna be funerals. You get a quiet spot in the shade for a grave. I get paid, cause I got murder for a 16, and I'm so much rich, I got a condo for a piggy bank. So much stash, I just laugh at your face. Blow a stack on David, cause I'm a pyro. Maniac for carrots with the rose gold. I was told by the OGs like my pops, if you can't whip their ass, the niggas get shot.
You say guns, I say we start live.
Well, if you got beef, son,
ya te la boca.
You'll meet me on an island where the Cubans meet the Haitians.
Herbal meets the verbal lyrical assassination.
From LA to Brooklyn, why you doing all that talking? Think you got a soul, but you're a dead man.
Yo, toast to host, from coast as we boast. When we meet again, I won't be cast, but that friendly ghost.
Yo, hear shots, like this show cops. Things are still the same, I'm still throwing props.
Why Clef would be real, let me build better yet. Kill or be killed, yo, be real, watch your grill.
Now let's get it all in perspective. For all y'all enjoyment, a song y'all can step with. Y'all appointed me to bring rap justice, but I ain't 5-0, y'all know it's Nas, yo. Great goose and a whole lot of hydro. Only describe us as soldiers, survivors. Stay laced in the best, well dressed with finesse in the white tee, looking for wifey. The girl who fly and talk so nicely. Put her in the coupe so she can feel the nice breeze. We could drive through the city, no doubt, but don't say my car's topless. Say the titties is out. Newness, here's the anthem. Put your hand up that you shoot with, count your loot with. Push the pool stick in your new crib, same hand that you hoop with. Swing around like you stupid.
You scared?
Pistol packing, crip bragging, folio. Who the only nigga in the club with the coolio? You ain't know? Yeah, you did. There it was. There it is. Is that coolio? No, bitch, let me in.
King of the town. Yeah, I've been that.
Motherfuckers don't wanna bring a bucket.
You know I click clack where you and your men's at.
And all your time in the club trying to duck up.
Do the smurf, do the wop, baseball bat.
If you walk by, nigga, I'ma not fly, nigga.
Rooftop like we bring an 88 back.
From your ass, you can come try, nigga.
They shooting. Oh, I made you look.
We come through the spot real heavy on the waist.
You a slave to a page in my rhyme book. Look.
So when they wanna move, we put them in their place.
I made up, come on. Get into it.
Get into it.
Let it ride.
Let it ride.
Let it ride.
Tonight's the night.
Ride, ride.
Yeah. I got my mind made up, come on. Get into it.
Get into it.
Let it ride.
Again, it's on. Can't be home. The crime got me in the zone. Homies blowing up the celly phone. The world knew I had to come once more. And just to let y'all know, I do my thing and still blow. Enough to burn. 10 mil sales confirmed. The most anticipated since Tyson's return. So come on, everybody, let's all get down.
Cause what we have is a brand new sound. All the mommies in the house getting live tonight. They wanna
zoom, 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 zoom,
zoom. And all my dogs feel a vibe tonight. They wanna
zoom, zoom, zoom.
All the mommies in the house getting live tonight. They wanna
zoom, 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 zoom,
and all my dogs feel a vibe tonight. They wanna
zoom, 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 zoom.
Say what?
Smith and Wesson performs, it's guns out. Not Daryl Simmons, but D. Yates, I runs house. Smack earth when it fire out, niggas who run mouth. Streets cold like the winter, you birds gon' fly south. Put you kids in the corner like time out. Look, nigga, I don't give two fucks what you rhyme about. All them boring war stories, your shorties, your line bout. Get your lord up in the hall where your body just lying
nigga,
out.
We don't get us, hoe hitters, you gotta fill us. Cocksuckers, you know why we go gorillas. Spot rushers, head busters, the flow so vicious. You motherfuckers mad you can't touch us. Gun holster on my shoulder, money folder. Bank stopper, grand dropper, six thrower. Louis rocker, bottle of
click popper. And for that green card, I get your ass lace proper.
See me, I ain't got the. Introduce myself, I'm the bank stopper. When the dice game proper, 718 partner. The zip code with a fifth blows, a clip load at your kinfolk to get dough. No info for the pigs though. We gutter, we don't talk. Leave it on the streets like skelly boards and old chalk. These hot things on our way somehow give us a cold heart. The closest thing to a Benz in my hood was a go-kart.
We don't stop. Any hood we feel like stomping through. Duh. Anyone that you just say you want it. Ooh. We from the small. Tryna get up, get out, and get that money true. We ain't who you wanna run into. Nah. We gon' stomp. Any hood we feel like stomping through. Duh. Anyone that you just say you want it. Ooh. We from the small. Tryna get up, get out, and get that money true. We ain't who you wanna run into.
Yeah, no. I get to choose it. Lover, never fuck without a rubber. Never in the seats like it on top of the cover. Money on the dresser. Drive a compressor. Top notch hoes get the most, not the less. Trash like the fuck for $40 in the club. Fucking up the game, bitch, it gets no love. She be cross country giving all that she got. A thousand a pop, I'm pulling Bentleys off the lot. I smashed up the gray one, ball be a red. Every time we hit the parking lot.
Map, para los que saben algo de 3D. Muy bueno. Bueno, entonces, mientras... Escucho sufrir a producción porque no puede entrar a Twitch. Porque se olvidó la contraseña o porque no le funciona, no sé por qué. Porque es... Y entonces... ¡No! Voy a revivir a Rubén. ¡Sí! ¡Ayudín! Este stream es... No es bilingüe. Voy a volver hacia allá porque me parece que es la posta. Ahí pude entrar. Entrar producción, ladies. La producción el problema. No lo saben. Les decía en el Discord... Que ya no tengo nada armado, pero lo vamos a hacer cada 5 suscriptores. Me parece excelente y lo vamos a hacer. Pero todavía no, para poner las cosas en claro. Vamos a ir a la Indie de larga. ¿Cómo se pronunciaría? Robin del Bosque se está agarrando a palos. A Bebe no, de Storm. Hoy estoy... Vamos a... Me saludó Tico. Hola, sos Lina. Soy Relina. ¿Cómo estás, querido?
would turn head. Some hoes wanna choose, but them bitches too scared. Me, your bitch chose me, you ain't a pimp, you a fairy.
Hey, yeah, you been rolling solo, time to get down with the team. The grass is greener on that other side, if you know what I mean. I'll show you shit you never seen, the seven wonders of the world. And I can make you the eighth if you wanna be my girl. Girl, I say my girl, I don't mean my woman, that ain't my style. Need a real street stoker, stoker, walk a green mile. Mile, piling up the paper on the dining room table. Cause you able to realize I'm the truth and not a fable. Hey, we rock your rush and sable, keep that chiller on the rack. What I look like with $1,000 shit up on my back. I'm a $1 million man, they need a $1 billion bitch. Put my pippin' in your life, watch your daddy get bitch. Easy as ABC, simple as 1, 2, 3. Get down with UGK, Pipsy, B, U, N, B. Cause what's a hoe with no pimp? And what's a pimp with no hoes? Don't be a lame. You